Okay, good morning, friends. Good to see everyone here. We're going to go ahead and let everyone settle in, and we'll find our places here. Well, opening weekend, we have Barbie. The Barbie movie is out. Oppenheimer is out. Has anyone seen these movies? Okay, Roger. All right, we have our Barbie movie tickets for tomorrow. but in light of these temporal entertainments and summer movies that come out, I was reminded of the eternal here in Psalm 34 that opens up with these words, where David writes, "I will bless the Lord at all times." Not just in the summertime, not just on vacation, but at all times. His praise shall be continually in my mouth. My soul makes its boast in the Lord. Let the humble hear and be glad. It's good to see everyone here. And thank you so much for coming, for making us part of your Sunday morning. Friends online, it's good to see you. Conley's and Doug and Brian and Michael, we see your names as well. Let's go ahead and find our center here, friends, and I'll open us up with a brief word of prayer. God of heaven, you have summoned us today, and you have given us the gift of the present moment. You have given us the gift of sunshine. You have given us the gift of community. You have given us the gift of friendship and companionship. You've given us the gift of love, both human love and divine love. And it is in that love that we drink from, that we find respite from our toils from. And you have given us the gift of your Spirit. Lord, we thank you. And may we be moved to move as you would have us, to be open to your openings, to be open to the gift of your word. And oh God, we are grateful. We are thankful. We open our hearts and minds to you now, today, and in this moment. What a gift. We thank you, oh Christ. For it's in your name we pray. Amen. And amen. Shirley.
Thank you.
Amen. And I know we just sat down, but let's go ahead and get up and extend the hand of fellowship and hellos to friends here in a time of meeting and greeting. Let's greet one another, friends. All right, let's go ahead and settle in here. Friends online, we see you. It's great to see you. Carolyn, good to see you. Tricia, Mike, Brian, good to see all of you. Will, we see your name up there. Jaja, we see your name. Michael, we see your name. Welcome. Friends online as well, we welcome you. We're going to go ahead and move into our time of scripture reading. Sean?
The reading today is from Jonah chapter 1, all of chapter 1. And it's the Peterson translation, which is a little more colloquial. One day, long ago, God's word came to Jonah, Amittai's son. Up on your feet and on your way to the big city of Nineveh. Preach to them. They're in a bad way, and I can't ignore it any longer. But Jonah got up and went the other direction, to Tarshish. Running away from God, he went down to the port of Joppa, found a ship headed for Tarshish, and paid the fare, went on board, joining those going, as far away from God as he could get. But God sent a huge storm at sea, the waves towering. The ship was about to break into pieces. The sailors were terrified. They called out in desperation to their gods. They threw everything that they were carrying overboard to lighten the ship. Meanwhile, Jonah had gone down into the hold of the ship to take a nap. He was sound asleep. The captain came to him and said, "What's this? Sleeping? Get up! Pray to your God. Maybe your God will see that we're in trouble and rescue us. Then the sailors said to one another, let's get to the bottom of this. Let's draw straws to identify the culprit on this ship who is responsible for this disaster. So they drew straws, and Jonah got the short straw. Then they grilled him, confess, why this disaster? What is your work? Who do you come from? What country? What family? He told them, I'm a Hebrew. I worship God, the God of heaven who made the sea and land. And at that, the men were frightened, really frightened, and said, what on earth have you done? As Jonah talked, the sailors realized that he was running away from God. They said to him, what are we going to do with you to get rid of this storm? By this time, the sea was wild, totally out of control. Jonah said, throw me overboard into the sea. Then the sea will stop. It's all my fault. I'm the cause of the storm. Get rid of me and you'll get rid of the storm. But no, the men tried rowing back to shore. They made no headway. The storm only got worse and worse, wild and raging. Then they prayed to God, oh God, don't let us drown because of this man's life, and don't blame us for his death. You are God. Do what you think is best. They took Jonah and threw him overboard. Immediately, the sea quieted down. The sailors were impressed, no longer terrified by the sea, but in awe of God. They worshiped God, offered a sacrifice, and made vows. Then God assigned a huge fish to swallow Jonah. Jonah was in the fish's belly 3 days and nights.
Thank you, Sean, for that reading. Jonah is one of those books in the Bible that collectively, even if we didn't have the book of Jonah, for some reason, the book of Jonah was torn out of our Bibles. But we all knew it, like just the general knowledge that we have of Jonah now. We could probably collectively reconstruct that story just based on our familiarity with it. It's one of those very familiar stories, one of those classic ones that, you know, it's full of colorful characters and dynamic action. And it's interesting. It's fun. It's fun to listen to. And the more you listen to it, the more nuanced it becomes, the story of Jonah. So we were only given chapter one. And I think we wanted to go there for a specific reason. Firstly, this being our third and final story at sea scripture lesson. We've been visiting certain contexts in stories in the scripture, and this is our third sea story. And I think what makes Jonah's story so memorable, even lovable, there's something kind of lovable and innocent about it, is how his character becomes this accidentally competent prophet. He's the accidental prophet, where he's really effective, but he's effective accidentally so. Jonah doesn't really try all that hard to do his job. All the while, Yahweh is able to accomplish his intended goals through Jonah, or maybe without Jonah's help. But it seems like wherever Jonah goes, the will of Yahweh is accomplished. The job gets done. So whether or not Jonah tried very hard or not, I guess it's a matter of outcomes. So perhaps, I was thinking about this, where else have I heard of this kind of a character that kind of blunders their way through life and causes great things to happen? Perhaps a contemporary cinematic comparison to Jonah would be the Tom Hanks movie, Forrest Gump. how throughout the movie, history itself in the movie, and if you've read the book, history itself is almost this benevolent character within the story. Forrest moves providentially throughout life, throughout the decades and the years, and however, it's through Gump's innocence, through Gump's ignorance, and even his kind of dim-witted way about him, that's kind of a non-PC thing to say, but, you know, that's how he's presented in the movie. He becomes an accidental agent of change and redemption in the lives of countless people. I always chuckle at that scene where Nixon invites him to stay at the Watergate Hotel. And later that night, because they're across the way at the Watergate Hotel, there are people with flashlights in a particular room that Forrest Gump calls the front desk and says, "Hey, the lights must be out in the room across the way there at the Watergate Hotel. You might want to have someone check that out." The next scene is Richard Nixon announcing his stepping down from President of the United States. I love that part. Likewise, there are these unintended accidents of redemption, maybe we could call it, that riddle the storyline of Jonah. Jonah gets it right, and yet Jonah doesn't really know he's getting it right. Jonah's so concerned about himself, or preserving himself, but that along the way, God is working, and things are coming together just right. Where even in Jonah's crisis of faith, the plans of Yahweh are accomplished. What might we gain from this story then? You know, we're revisiting chapter one. I've preached on this book maybe a year ago or something like that. We've revisited recently. What might we gain then from this story? Perhaps this is a good story to consider if you've ever experienced any sort of reluctance, even within your own life, a reluctance to take up or maybe to stick with the straight and narrow way, you know. I'm reluctant to do that or to stick with it. I don't know. This would be a good story to visit. If you can relate to any of these words as a part of your own faith journey, then I think you would be right at home in the book of Jonah. And consider some of these words. The feeling of apprehension, to feel a sense of apprehension, to feel doubt, to feel fear, to experience or to have a sense of flight, to hide oneself from God. Let's be honest. We've all visited one of these at one point of our lives, you know, at one time or another. We've all visited one of these words and one of these themes that come to the surface in the story of Jonah. So that's what I like about Jonah, is it's an honest story. It's a really relatable story, even if it's relatable in a way in things that where we don't feel like we've shined our best. And where we have been in a time in life where we are proud of ourselves. Maybe it's the part of our lives where we're embarrassed about ourselves. And yet, even there, we can relate to the story of Jonah. All of these themes appear in the story, and perhaps to convey to us that these are not outliers to our response of faith. These themes of apprehension, of fear, of flight, of running away from God, you know, these aren't just the outliers of faith where no one understands and no one experiences that in the faith journey. No, instead, I think that they've been written down and canonized so that we can see these as a normalized outcome of faith. These are typically normal responses to the faith journey where we wrestle with God, where we feel like we're running away from God, where we're apprehensive to trust God in a certain area of life. It's a very honest book. It's a very honest story. and it appeals to that type of honesty. What benefit is there then in learning about this, these kind of lesser things that we may not talk so much about or we keep privately to ourselves throughout the week? Perhaps it's that following God means that we often will have to confront our own failures and personal shortcomings as a part of our faith journey. The faith journey isn't just us looking good all the time, looking polished in something that we're proud of and that we always like to set up on the top shelf. You know, I sometimes wonder about Jonah, the fact that, what does he think that his story is canonized in the book as a book in the Bible? You know, where he's showcased as kind of a less than glimmering and gleaming hero of the Bible. What does he have to say about that? And yet, it's there. It's a part of our faith journey. It's a book in the Bible where we can relate to. So it's a humbling process then to be reminded ultimately of our reliance on God. Our reliance on God is showcased here in this story. To be reminded that even when our faith and actions may falter, much like Jonah, God's character and heart towards me and towards you remains faithful. Despite our falters, despite our shortcomings, God remains faithful to us. God remains faithful to Jonah. God remains faithful to what God wants to do through Jonah with the lives of these sailors and to the city of Nineveh. God is faithful. That's a kind of a highlighting thread throughout this book. Jonah 1 then highlights how this divine faithfulness is represented in the story and still speaks to us today in at least three of the following ways. I had three areas of the book that I wanted to highlight about how God's faithfulness is represented in the book in the first chapter here of Jonah. And it's firstly this: God's faithfulness extends and stretches our present understanding of God. God's faithfulness, it extends and it stretches our present understanding of God. In other words, God isn't just faithful when we finally get it. When we get it, well, that's when God is going to be faithful to us. No, God was faithful the whole time, even in the midst of Jonah's misunderstanding. Even in the midst of Jonah failing in his representation of God, of faith, the faith of Israel. Honestly, getting it seems to be the least important thing when it comes to our relationship to the divine will. God wasn't too concerned about unpacking why he wanted Jonah to go to Nineveh. He didn't explain that. He just said, "This is what I want you to do." And Jonah ultimately said, "No." Instead, God's interest in people tends to prefer and have a preference towards right action as being superior to the human intellect. It isn't so much how much you know. It's more about how you're acting and what your behavior is like that God seems to have a keen interest on. We read in the Gospels in the early Jesus tradition the saying that those who wish to be involved or included in the activities of God must first become like children, Jesus would say. And to be like a child isn't to really have that much of a firm grasp on the human intellect, as much as it is, as it does have a sense of action and a sense of living trust with our relationship with God. To become the least among everyone else, if you really want to participate in God's ways on earth, Jesus says that's the way that is set out for the disciples, and ultimately that's the invitation of the church. To be willing to be least, to be willing to become childlike in our trust and our confidence in the divine will of God. Even if that divine will may not make sense to us in our intellect. Jonah was invited to be a part of a work of mercy in the story that didn't readily fit into his personal theology at that time of what Yahweh was supposed to be about. To extend the mercy of God to those whom Jonah, along with much of Israel at that time, would have considered their enemies. God, you can't possibly be expecting me to give a message or to be merciful to those people over there on the other side of the fence. That can't possibly be in your plans. And yet it was. And Jonah was invited to be a part of that story. This is a picture of how the faithfulness of God works within our lives and the world. Jonah's task, along with ours, becomes the task to love that which God loves as God loves it, even when we don't fully understand the work. Understanding is not a requisite for obedience and for action, for right action. To love that which God loves as God loves it. Secondly, God's faithfulness becomes the teacher of faith then in this story. God's faithfulness becomes the teacher of faith. I want to ask you and just a question that you can kind of maybe identify on your own. What makes a good teacher? What makes a good teacher? Perhaps you can think of a teacher or a professor that made a positive impact on your life and on your learning journey. Perhaps it was how they were able to make learning and knowledge accessible to you, relatable to you. What makes a good teacher? Who have been those teachers in your life that they've made a difference? Maybe their personality or their way of teaching really connected with you. But you connect with whoever that person is, whoever that teacher is, with those who help you have those aha moments in life. And a really good teacher are those that you have a lot of aha moments around. Every time I'm around this person, or every time I go into this person's class, I have an aha moment. That's what makes a good teacher. Interestingly, in this first chapter of Jonah, such aha moments come to those surrounding Jonah before Jonah gets it. The sailors offer us a prime example of Jonah's mission to Nineveh. It's almost like the Bible loves doing this, offering a microcosm, in you know, kind of a small example of kind of a more a larger task at hand. Well, if it can work on a small scale, it's almost to be understood that it can also work on a large scale. And so there's this kind of microcosm at work there in the boat, where a community of people who have heard of the God of Israel, but they're not quite at a place where they would claim this God or belong to this God. Oh yeah, we know about the God of Israel. He's not ours, but we know about him. Yet by the end of the chapter, they are worshiping, they're making sacrifices to, they're making vows to Yahweh at the end of the chapter. Whatever it is that they experienced, you know, namely the storm, but also Jonah's confession, it seemed to work accidentally, right under Jonah's nose. These sailors learned the lesson that they were given on the sea. They got it, even before the prophet of Yahweh was able to get it. How ironic. That's that sweet irony there in that story. The people around Jonah could read the writing on the wall. They were willing to change, while ironically, the one who should know doesn't. We revisit that oftentimes in the Gospels. You know, Jesus, namely in Jesus. You know, he comes and he's around religious leaders of his nation and of the synagogue. And while a lot of people acknowledge Jesus for who he was, the Christ, those that are really in charge and who should know and would be the professionals of ancient world Judaism, they're hesitant to call Jesus of Nazareth the Christ. They would say, no, it's not there. It's not what we're expecting. And yet those on the outside, those who were most willing to receive Christ, were some of the first people to say, you are the Christ. You are God's promised one. God's faithfulness becomes the teacher of faith. And even to those that were, who should know, who should be the most teachable, they need an extra dose to help get the point across. And that's what we get. It's going to take something a little bit more drastic than to stop Jonah's present course that we read there towards the end of the chapter. Thirdly, God's faithfulness can be present within that which doesn't feel like faithfulness. God's faithfulness can be present in situations where you would say, this does not feel like faithfulness at all, what we're experiencing. The fish in the Jonah story represents an uncomfortable faithfulness. I would absolutely say that. God is being faithful to Jonah. But I don't know if Jonah would be able to look on and experience that and say, oh, this too is the faithfulness of God. The chapter ends with Jonah being in the belly of the fish that Yahweh appointed. What's going on here? Beyond just putting an end to Jonah's runaway plans, there's something more. Let me extrapolate just a little bit. When you're in the belly of a fish, you can't help but think that life is over. Can you just put yourself there? This is it. This is the end. Look what I've gotten myself into. It's over. You know? That's what you're thinking. When you're in the belly of a fish, you really start to think about your life decisions, don't you? Okay, what did I decide? What did I choose that really got me here to this place? You have time to think. Jonah had time to really mull over his decisions. You would eventually come around and ask the question, ultimately speaking, wait a minute, whose story is this anyhow? Is this the story of Jonah? Is it all about Jonah? Or is it about something more that, you know, speaking for Jonah in his place, is it about something more that I was invited into but failed to grasp, failed to kind of hop onto, to believe in the action sense? Whose story is it anyhow? If the book was about Jonah's story, I think it would end on chapter 1. That would be the end. And we would be left with this kind of curious story that ends quite tragically. Okay, what do we do with that? But it's God's story, isn't it? And the chapters go on. We get 3 more chapters. 4. We get more chapters in what's going on in the story. We know the rest of it too. We could probably reconstruct it. What happens after the end of chapter 1? We could collectively get a pretty good idea of what happens there on the rest of it. It's the story, but the fact that it's God's story, it's the story of God saving the seemingly unredeemable. It's a salvation story. God saving the hopeless. God sending to those that would surely never listen. They're dyed in the wool, unchangeable. So Jonah thought. And yet, something miraculous happens in that story. It's the story of God saving the seemingly unredeemable. Jonah needed to learn this lesson for himself. He needed to learn this lesson not from his national identity, of which he was, you know, probably pretty proud about. When they asked him, "Who are you?" he was ready to say, "I'm an Israelite." When they asked about, "What do you do for a living?" he was ready to answer, "I'm a prophet. The God that created heaven and earth." It was right there. But he needed to learn this lesson for himself, first-handedly, to experience a sense of salvation and the second chance of redemption. And maybe that's the story of Jonah being swallowed up by a fish. It's Jonah learning for himself what he was tasked to give to other people that also needed that salvation and redemption. It's a beautiful story. It's a relatable story. And it's something that beckons us to embody, to live into. We can identify with the story of Jonah not just because of its characters, not because of its outlandish themes and the drama that are described there within the book, but there's a part of us that we too have experienced a salvation. We too have experienced a redemption. We too have experienced this life-giving gift of God's faithfulness doing its work in our lives. Okay, so it's one thing to receive it. It's one thing to have experienced it. The book of Jonah is very missional in a sense that, okay, now that you've seen it, now that you've experienced, you don't really have the right to keep that to yourself. You can give that away now. Speak out of your experience now. Be in touch with what has happened to you. Remember what has happened to you and give that away to those that would be willing and ready to receive it. Well, who are those who are ready and willing to receive it? Probably those that you think would never be willing to receive them. How are you challenged by the book of Jonah? If anything, by this first chapter. And if even in this first chapter we see some pretty strong and just powerful examples of God's faithfulness, where is that faithfulness at work in your life now? And how is that speaking to you? How are you being challenged today because of God's faithfulness in your life, active and present here and now? I would like us to sit with that query in our time of open worship. If you feel so moved to share in vocal ministry, we have a microphone. Friends online, if you feel so moved to share in vocal ministry concerning these queries or anything else that you feel so moved of spirit to share, make sure that you're unmuted so we can hear you. Let's center down, friends, and attend to that inward teacher of the light of Christ. Open worship. Friends online, good to see you. Friends online, just so you know, we do see you. The computer screen is projected. I want to go ahead and move into a time for any sort of praise or concern, items of concern that you would like to make known to the meeting. I did have a couple that I wanted to start off with. Caleb, our friend Caleb, is in Kenya right now. And I messaged him a little bit, so he sends his greetings. He arrived safely, and we are grateful that Caleb has this sense of homecoming there as he is visiting friends and family, and we know that that was a place that he wanted to go. Also, Stu Wilcutts seems to be doing pretty well on his healing journey, and we want to just continue to hold him in light. And I believe he's going to be, the last time I spoke with him, he's going to be going home relatively soon. He's at a rehabilitation there at West Hills, but he seems to be doing well enough where that's going to be transitioning then into his home there. Megan.
I have a prayer request and a praise. The prayer request is, there was a shooting yesterday at Good Samaritan Hospital, and it was related to the labor and delivery department. My team just went through a fairly significant security concern, and so this was our ultimate fear that would happen to us, and unfortunately it's happened to another team, not the same perpetrator or anything, but this is, you know, the highest emotion departments in the hospital are the ED and labor and delivery. There's a lot going on usually in both. But those nurses and providers and everyone going back to work is gonna be really difficult for them. They've cleared a lot of the beds and stuff. OB is very small in Portland. It's a small specialty, so sharing those patients is really difficult to kind of spread that out. So just kind of in general, be in prayer for the OB community and the hospital at large. The person who was killed was a security guard. But just everyone is very much on edge right now. I think hospital-wide, this is kind of a huge fear. On that note, but not at all, I'm taking a new position starting in September. I'm gonna go to Kaiser, still in the OB field, but in a clinic, so not being on call 24 hours a day sounds amazing, but I think a lot of you were definitely a part of this and praying, and you know, this was not an easy decision for me to make, but I'm excited for the potential. And getting to do something that I love in a different setting. So thank you all for your prayers for that.
Thanks, Megan.
I've got two prayer requests to add on to yours. Of course, it ended the suspect was shot near where I live, and I think there were probably people in that parking lot near Albertson's that were probably affected by that. And that whole block was shut off for 11 o'clock last night. They were still out there dealing with that. The other is, you mentioned Oppenheimer. The movie, I understand, starts with a public service announcement about that evil that is still going on from what happened. It is still affecting the whole state of New Mexico because there are families and tribes that are dealing with all kinds of rare cancers because that test was done so poorly. And Congress has allotted money for what they call downwinders. Only in Nevada because of the constant testing there, but that initial test affected 46 states, which only leaves two that weren't, and I guess Alaska and Hawaii as well, which are probably too far away, but people continue to suffer from this.
Some of you know my sister, Marion Pruitt, and she passed away on Thursday. She'd been unwell, I'll call it that, for a long time. And she has three children. If you could pray, say them by name, Susan, Charisse, and Scott, and there are several grandchildren too. But the thing that hit me was they all knew that she was in a lot of pain, and they were pleased for the release, but the loss, balancing those two has been a real challenge for them and will continue to be for a while. So if you find it in your heart to pray for Charisse and Susan and Scott, and even in general her grandchildren, that would be much appreciated.
Well, I have a praise. House sold, and it went through all of the various things that cause worry and concern. So I'm so pleased, and I thank prayer from Mark and the elders, and hopefully we'll go ahead and make a new home for myself. Thank you.
Anything else we want to hold in light? Carolyn.
Yes. We've been praying for Floyd, and he went to the hospital by ambulance yesterday. And it's believed he was had a lot of symptoms, and what's believed is that it is probably related to his kidneys, and because he was not feeling well, he had missed two of his dialysis appointments. So hopefully, he's on the right track now. And I'm home because my legs just felt wonky, hard to walk. And as I sat here, I realized that yesterday I was doing a lot of moving things around and stuff. And I think I literally, that has to do with what's going on. And it's happened before, and so the remedy is to walk on grass, on uneven terrain, and that way it just puts everything back in order. So let's let that happen.
Thank you, Carolyn.
Yeah.
We'll be remembering your friend. Hi, Darla.
I don't know why I'm embarrassed about this, but I need some prayers. I'm having a problem. I'm apparently carrying too much water weight, and I'm having a terrible time getting rid of it. My doctor is doing everything she can, but it's affecting me in ways that you wouldn't expect. It's depressing me in ways I had no idea. I love to sew. I'm in the middle of sewing a quilt top for my daughter-in-law. My living room chair is here. 3 feet away is my sewing machine, and I have not had the ability to get up and walk that 3 feet to sit at my sewing machine and sew. And it hurts. And it makes me angry that I can't just get up and walk over to that sewing machine. So I could really use your prayers, if you wouldn't mind. And I'd like to thank the Lord for this absolutely beautiful day. I can't overlook that. Thank you.
Thank you, Darla. Our Reedwoods Latino Friends group is doing something fun where they have traveled to the coast for their worship meeting and just kind of a time together. So may we hold them in the light as they travel and as they enjoy a time of community. Let's hold the light, friends. Loving God, we are remembering many faces and friends that have been mentioned in this time, and we ask that you would hold tenderly those that are in need of healing, that are in need of your restoration, and that are going through the process of becoming well. Lord, specifically, we are thinking of Carolyn's friend, and we're thinking of Stu. We are remembering Suzanne and Charisse and Scott. We are remembering Darla. Oh God, we ask that your spirit would, that a healing work and that an ministering spirit would be upon them. Lord, we are mindful of the ways in which blessings have fallen in pleasant places in our lives, as Megan has mentioned and announced her decision, as Celia has announced the ways in which change has come into her life. And Lord, as we even think of our friends there on the coast, Lord, such blessings are good to hear. And they encourage us. And yet, Lord, we know that it just seems like we live in a city where we are plagued with violence, and that our culture has an addiction to this. And yet we are called to be a people of peace, and we are called to be a people who are familiar with the heart of God. And that is the way of peace. So may we hold this peace testimony well and effectively. Lord, may whatever changes and in whatever we can do to enact change, may we be responsible and diligent and dutiful in how we can make our world a more peaceable place, for that truly is thy intent. God, we thank you for this meeting and for the way in which Spirit has moved and spoken. For it's in Christ's name we pray. Amen. Just a few announcements that I wanted to go over before we move on from here. Tuesday Bible study, per the norm, is this Tuesday at 10 o'clock to 11:15. We're going to continue in our study in the Gospel of Mark, where we are enjoying that time together and that study. So again, we still have study guides if that's something new that you wanted to integrate into your weekly schedule. Next week, we have some events here. Next week, we're gonna be hearing from Gil George. He's going to be sharing. Gil is a communications worker for FWCC. And his office is right over that, in that direction, right next to my office. And Gil and I bump into one another and speak to one another throughout the week. Gil does attend West Hills Friends, but he's going to be bringing the prepared message to us next week, titled Transitioning and Reorientation, a Study of Psalm 40. You know, and so I think it's just going to be a good message and a timely message, and I encourage you to come and see our dear friend Gil as he brings this message. Next week also, starting after our worship meeting, starting at 11 a.m., we're going to have our third installment of World Cafe. This is going to be, World Cafe is sharing stories of travel and discovery. And our guests are Quinlan and Coleman Weimer, who live in California right now, but they are former students there at George Fox, and whom we've got to know pretty well before they moved to California. And the name of their talk is Dwelling Together in Unity, and they're going to talk about their time in Israel and Palestine and how they were able to serve in that area of the world a couple of years ago. And so we're looking forward to that. This will be a Zoom thing, so we're going to stay in here this time next week for World Cafe starting at 11. It may or may not go until 12, but I just put that time anyway. But it will be a time of hearing from them and then hearing about these experiences that they had there in the Middle East as they went over there to serve. On that note, those are our highlights here for what's coming up next week. So all sorts of guests next week here, and just encourage you to come out for that. Well, on that note, we're going to go ahead and pass this along. Dwight, I believe you're our online host, so we'll... Hey, Dwight. We're going to go ahead and pass it along to you. And friends online, so good to see all of you. And friends in house, we have donuts and coffee in the foyer. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. July 20th, 1977, Marc Kondo came into the world. And it was a thread on some text messages where elders were sharing where were they at in 1977. And, you know, some interesting responses that I'm grateful for. But thank you. Thank you, Shirley. Thank you. I would drop the hint to people that I told that I was 46, and I was expecting them to be like, oh, you're getting up there, but they would all say, you're still young. I was like, well, I guess I am. All right, we'll look at it that way. Thank you so much for the song and for sharing my joy as I celebrate 46 years old, class of 77. It's a joy to celebrate with you. Go in peace, dear friends.
I think I remember 1977.